it's no secret that we have nihilist mass movements, in effect, right? The alt-left mushhead movement are essentially nihilists, right? Don't believe in God, don't believe in their country, don't believe in the Constitution, don't believe in anything. They believe in some idiotic ritual of multiculturalism or political correctness or identity politics. Those are simply tricks that are used to fill the void when nihilism takes over the entire thing. Putin, you'd have to ask Putin, what is it? What is the goal with Putin? Is it that he really believes the Russian system is superior, that the Russian system could offer a solution to the problems of the world? There used to be Russians who thought that. They were Soviet Russians not so long ago, and this had a certain coherence. I think it was wrong, but it was in many ways a respectable point of view. It had an interior logic to it. It made sense. You could see what they were going about. They would say the communist system is better, and we will bury you. We will prove by superior progress, superior achievements, a better standard of living, that the Russian communist, Soviet communist system is better. Putin doesn't believe that in a million years. There's no hint of that. What you see, rather, is the desire to destroy what exists. It's a very nihilist approach, right? To say, well, there are these bilateral institutions. Let's look for the cracks. Let's look for the fissures. Let's drive wedges into the cracks and fissures. Let's try to make sure that nothing works. The U.S. has a system, right? There's a great envy of the U.S. in the sense that the U.S. system of government works fairly well. It's fairly stable. Democratic Party, such as it is probably the oldest continuous large-scale political institution in the world. The U.S. form of government is now one of the oldest and most stable. This obviously brings problems with it, but it is. And you can look at some place like China and you can say, that seems to be going pretty well, except that you have not solved the problem of self-government. You have not. And that could exact a terrible price further along the way. And same thing with Russia. We have this strange Siamese relationship between the government, especially the power ministries of the government, the defense, the FSB, the GRU, the intelligence, the secret police, and so forth, the border troops, that entire thing, the apparatus of coercion. Then the economic oligarchs, the financiers, the pirates and bandits who wrenched into their own hands the state property of the Soviet Union after all those Soviet citizens had suffered for so many decades to put that together and then defend it. And then, of course, it shades over very rapidly into the criminal nomenclatura, right? The nomenclatura being the oligarchy and the government officials, party officials, well, not so much party anymore, but to some extent still. But there's also then the mafia, right? The mafia and the criminal oligarchy. Now, does anybody seriously think that that system is superior, that that system could be used to reform the world? No. So the content of the Russian policy is simply the assertion of a hollow pretense to say Russia should be a great power, Russia should be a world power, Russia is entitled to equal treatment and equal respect and equal dignity. I think those are all fine. I have no problem. I'd give you all that right away if it were up to me. But somehow the idea that in the name of that, you're going to destroy European Union, you're going to try to bust up NATO and then try to take over the pieces, I guess. I don't see why, right? You could say you have plenty of territory. You don't seem to be doing a very great job governing the territory that you have. Why don't you think about developing what you do have rather than grasping for the Baltic states or these other places? Now, I've said before, Donetsk, Lugansk is different. That's a real authentic revolution. And there was help from Russia, but a lot of it was autochthonous, spontaneous, indigenous. That's fine. And indeed, the Russians chose their allies much more wisely in Syria. They had it built in. They were allied to the Assad family when that was a very bad thing to do. But then when the Assad family got somewhat better with Bashar, that became a good thing. And they were always better off with the Assads than they would have been with jihadis, right? With these crazies, ISIS, Nusra, these bloody characters, right? The caliph, the kidnapper, and the cannibal, right? That's who the US got at the end. So, nihilism. So this guy, Wehner, points out that Trump is in effect a nihilist. And I think if there's going to be a meeting of the minds, it's going to be on the basis of nihilism. That means that we don't want this summit to lead to a sellout, because that's what it's likely to lead to, right? We've been warning since last week. Go back and look at the Munich, infamous Munich sellout of September 1938, when Britain and France, Chamberlain, Daladier, and some others, under the chairmanship of the Duce Mussolini, consigned Czechoslovakia into the hands of Nazi Germany. And it led to the extinction of the country quite soon, although a Slovakian rump state, I think, did then survive. Nihilism. Any deal is likely to be a sellout, again, because the United States representation is so woeful and so inadequate and minority, unpopular, weak, disoriented president who goes flitting from one diversion, scandal hopping, as we've called it, to try to keep one step ahead of his critics. Indeed, while the bureaucracy is churning out monstrous policies, and the most monstrous is the attack on Obamacare, right? The thing that's going to lead to loss of life measured in tens of thousands of people. That's what's going on behind the scenes. Now, remember, this is a kind of a modern American urban nihilism that we're seeing. It's the nihilism of a billionaire or a quasi-billionaire or a would-be billionaire, whatever you can call this guy. And on the Russian side, there's a very strong nihilistic strain, right? The word, the modern word for nihilism, I think, appears for the first time in one of the novels of Ivan Turgenev, published in the 1860s in Russia, Fathers and Sons. And what he writes about there is that there had been an attempt at liberal reform in Russia. Liberal reform simply meant elections, the right to vote, a written constitution, certain guarantee of rights, something like a constitutional monarchy, or more monarchy than constitutional. And you could see this coming to the fore in the Decembrist agitation of 1820, when they wanted the officers in the army wanted Constantine and Constitution. That was their demand. The joke is that the officers said to the troops, "Here, guys, go out and chant, you want Constantine and Constitution." And Constantine e Constitutia, and a lot of the troops thought that Constitution was Constantine's wife because they didn't know what a constitution was. So this is part of the problem. Constitutions were very popular at that time, and the American model is the reason, very influential. So they wanted that in Russia too. So those were the Westernizers, those were the liberals. And they thought that science, education, enlightenment, individual rights, and things like that should be instituted in Russia as well. And instead, they got the Decembrists were mowed down. Nicholas I came in, and this guy was sadistic. I think the hobby of his life was to torment Alexander Pushkin, the great Russian poet, and one of the greatest ever anywhere. We all for Pushkin. Nicholas I gave him a really, really hard time, and there was no reform. Right? This was a pretty benighted time. So what you get, we've gone through this a little bit before. On the one hand, the liberal, and again, liberal, it doesn't mean what you think it means today. It just means what I just said, like right? There should be these enlightened reforms, and of course, to go with that, economic development. Right, we're going to see later on. with Cassius Clay, Lincoln's ambassador to Russia, that he talks about a dirigistic economic development, not free trade, but